Sir, I'm claiming host. We are live.
Okay, okay, sir.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to another edition of our Learn from the Masters series. For today's talk, we'll be having Dr. Divyansh Mishra, who's our consultant in the vitreoretina department at Sankara Hospital, Bangalore, and he'll be talking on retinopathy of prematurity. Over to you, Dr. Divyansh.
Good afternoon, all. Thank you, sir. Thank you for the opportunity. This topic is really, really important and very close to us, being a retina surgeons, managing children who are premature. And starting with my topic of ROP or retinopathy of prematurity, would like to thank our mentor, Dr. Mahesh and Dr. Rajesh, to help me out with this. Long list of topics in an ROP, because it's a very important topic where we need to know what is ROP, how did it develop, pathogenesis, when to screen, whom to screen, how to screen, what to screen, what all to be used at the time of screening, and if treatment is required, then what all options do we have in our armamentarium to treat, like either cryo, laser, anti-VEGFs, and multiple treatment options which we have, surgeries, buckling, and all. First and foremost, introduction. Yes, the ROP is a retinal vascular disease which was first described by Terry in 1942, which they call it as retrolental fibroplasia because it looked like a detachment which is just behind the lens or pupil. Kestney in 1949 suggested that the ROP is inversely proportional to the body weight. Health in 1951 suggested the name, which presently we call it as ROP, or retinopathy of prematurity, or retinopathy associated with prematurity. Campbell in 1951 suggested that it has a relationship with intense oxygen therapy and subsequent development of ROP. So considering the present era where we have pandemics and epidemics, yes, this also is an epidemic. The first epidemic arised in 1950 to 1960, where a higher amount of oxygen saturation was given at the time of resuscitation and afterwards in neonatal care, which caused to more deaths and more ROPs. Then the second epidemic occurred in developed countries where, because more children or more younger children or less weight children survived in those developed ROP. Right now, the third epidemic is occurring in developing countries like us, Southeast Asia, because of variable NICU care, variable oxygen saturation which is provided to the child, and very low birth weight or low birth weight children being surviving because of the better NICU care, poor oxygen management, and yes, poor management of ROP and less availability of experts to manage ROP in Southeast Asia and specifically in India. So these are incidences in India which are reported from 20 to 52 which had ROP in India. The most recent study showed that it is ranging between 20 to 30% of the kids of neonates. So how does a normal vascularization occur? So it starts at around 16 weeks of gestation, and then gradually by around 28 to 32 weeks, the nasal vascularization is complete. And by around 40 weeks, the temporal vascularization is complete. How does this vascularization occur in a neonate? There are two pathogenesis. One is a vasculogenesis, where the normal blood vessel or the major blood vessels are formed by endothelial progenitor cells, which later on coalesce and then form a lumen. And then that lumen is stabilized to form a blood vessel. Yes, there is an angiogenesis or a hand-to-hand, hand-in-glove kind of a vasculogenesis and angiogenesis which occurs. It's not the major blood vessels, but the shoots out of it, or the vascular spurting which comes out of it, which forms because of this angiogenesis, which is a VEGF-dependent development. So which are the major risk factors? Very low birth weight, prematurity and high oxygen saturation, these are the major risk factors. There are other associated risk factors like acidosis, apnea, PDA, sepsis, blood transfusion, intravitreal hemorrhages. What is the pathogenesis for ROP? So the classical pathogenesis, which was described by Artson and Patz, is the O2 associated pathogenesis, where a vasoconstriction occurs, which causes vasoocclusion, which causes endothelial cell proliferation, and then a neovascular invasion. So, there was then
15.
I'm hearing certain sounds in between. Shall I stop for that? Is somebody asking a query?
No, it's okay, Dr. Divyansh, please continue.
So the other theory is the spindle cell theory, which was proposed by Kurtz, where he proposed that the spindle cell exposed to hyperoxic environment causes an insult, and which causes the stoppage or migration of the spindle cells and cancellation. This is how it occurs. So in utero, there is a perfect environment for the development. Most importantly is the intrauterine growth factors. Once the child is born as a premature, the retinal vasculature development becomes a little slow. Why that occurs is because of increased oxygen, which is an ambient oxygen, or the oxygen which is provided by the caregivers. Decrease in VEGF, how does that occur? We would discuss it just in the next slide. An increase in ROS, that is a reactive oxidation species, which causes injury to the newer formed endothelial cells, and yes, again, which causes capillary destruction. So there is a part of retina, as you can see, which is avascular, and a part of retina which is vascular. So what happens is still the oxygen stress, if it continues, or if there is a fluctuation of the oxygen stress, then this radical oxygen species are increased, and decrease in erythropoietin level, which causes again increase in VEGF level, which acts at the edges where the vascular and avascular retina is there. And because of the VEGF being increased, there is an angiogenic signal to it, which causes a new blood vessel proliferation. That's the phase two. So as you are discussing, hypoxia or HIFs, that is hypoxia associated factors, would increase the VEGF, which would in turn decrease the normal vascularization. As we can see over here, is a normal vascularity which has stopped because of the hypoxia, again because of increased anti-VEGF. But yes, again, because of the increased anti-VEGF, what is occurring is something which is called as a vasoproliferation, or an abnormal proliferation which occurs, which forms the new blood vessels, and sometimes it enters into the vitreous cavity, which is called as stage 3. Yes, so most important part of ROP is how to classify and nomenclatures associated with it. What is a zone? What is an extent? What is a stage? And what are plus? So ICROP, International Council of ROP, was first, which they had the first paper in 1984 and 1987, which gave us an idea what are the zones, extent, and stages. Stages were from 1 to 5, we discussed in details. And then they revisited this in 2005, and then found out that there's something which is called as an APROP, or an aggressive posterior ROP, and there is something which is called as a pre plus also. And most importantly, the practical clinical tool to identify what is zone 1, because that's the most important zone for the vision. So these are the right eye and the left eye. As you can see, this is the right eye, this is the nasal part, and this is the left eye. So the zone 1 is the distance between the disc and the fovea, double the distance of it on the either side. If you use a 30 diopter lens or a 20 diopter lens and keep the lens, the edge, one edge on the nasal side of the disc, this is the exact area where the zone 1 would be. The zone 2 would be the nasal most margin of the aura. And there would be a remnant area of the zone 3 in the temporal, which is called as the temporal crescent, which is zone 3. So these are three different zones, zone 1, zone 2, and zone 3. So these are the extents. Yes, in present era, basically we do not discuss about extent, but yes, I would come down to the details to it. So every 30 degree is equal to 1 clock hour. So there may be different stages of diseases. So that's why it would be better that when we draw, it would be according to each and every clock hour rather than a contiguous sector to it. So what are stages? Stages are stage 1, which is called as a demarcation line, where you would see that there's a sudden abrupt ending of vascular and avascular retina. As we can see, here is an avascular retina where there is no sudden or abrupt ending to it. The blood vessels are just going and bluntly ending. There is no demarcation line over there. That is not a stage 0. This is stage 1, where, as you can see, a demarcation line would be formed, a white line. I would show the images later. And then something which is called a ridge. So ridge is a line which is having a three-dimensional structure, a height and breadth to it. So that is called as a ridge. And if we have a neovascularization which grows over the ridge and into the vitreous cavity, which is called as an extra-retinal neovascularization, that is the stage three. If it is just on the ridge, it is still stage two. So this is what is a demarcation line. As we can see, the sudden abrupt ending of the blood vessels with a whitish ridge or a line, not a ridge, a line, which does not have a three-dimensional structure to it, a thickness, a breadth to it. And yes, there is an avascular retina temporal. This is stage two, where as we can see, the ridge is having a three-dimensional structure, a thickness and a breadth also with it, where this we can see a vascular retina, which is ending. And then this is an avascular retina anteretina. This is stage three, where we can see the ridge is so thickened and then it is partly elevated. And also some new blood vessels are coming into the vitreous cavity at various levels, as we can see. So this is stage four. Stage four is divided into A and B, where A is where the detachment is not involving the fovea or the macula. As you can see in this case, the fovea is here and the detachment is somewhere in the lasered area. As you can see again over here, the detachment is far temporal and not involving the fovea. The stage 4B, where the fovea is also involved, as you can see, there is some kind of attraction which is causing the fovea to be dragged. That is called the stage 4B. Yes, there is stage 5, where there is a complete retinal detachment. And then we can see what is something which is called the retrolental fibroplasia, or a complete detached retina, which is just behind the lens or behind the pupil. This is stage 5. Stage 5 on B scan have different types, open-open, where the anterior is open and the posterior funnel is also open. This is the anterior and this is the posterior part. Open or narrow, or open or closed, where the anterior is open and the posterior one is tight, shut, closed. It can be narrow and narrow, where the anterior and posterior both are closed or closed. And the other one, the last one, which is the anterior, which is closed, and the posterior, which is open. I do not have a B scan presently with me for that. Yes, what is called as a plus disease. The plus disease is very important to identify whether the treatment is required or not required. A follow-up needs to be done, how frequently. So it is characterized by significant vascular dilatation, as we can see, where the venous dilatation and tortuosity is there. Along with that, the arteries are also tortuous, as we can see. And it has to involve at least two quadrants, which has to be. So this is a classic image, which is called as a plus disease, which has to be kept as a reference for us to understand what is plus, because we need to know what is pre-plus also. There are other associated factors in plus, where we can, something which is called as a poor pupillary dilatation. Most importantly, we need to rule, look for very, if the child is very premature or somewhere around 26 to 28 weeks, something which is called as a tunica vascular lentis, which is a normal developmental blood vessels around the lens, which extends from the iris. Sometimes those can be engorged, but still the pupil would be dilated. This would not be called as plus. The plus where the pupil would not dilate and it would be severely engorged. As you can see, the engorgement of the tunica vascular lentis is very significant. Other is a vitreous haze or an anterior chamber haze. As you can see, the disc is just seen in this case. So the haze can be because of vitreous or something in the anterior chamber. As we were discussing a pre-plus disease, pre-plus is not what the plus was, where the dilatation and tortuosity is not equal to what we were seeing before. It is much less and not involving two quadrants as such. And usually a pre-plus disease can be gradually seen and it resolves by itself. As I told you, this plus image should be always in our mind, that what a reference for plus is there. So what is called as threshold ROP? The threshold ROP was provided by a cryo treatment ROP protocol or study, where they told that 5 contiguous clock hours, as you can see over here, the 5 contiguous clock hours should be there with a plus disease, and it has to be in zone 2 or zone 1, and it is should be a stage 3. Stage 3 means a ridge which is having a new blood vessel which is coming in the anterior into the vitreous cavity. This is something where it is non-contiguous, but if it is non-contiguous, it has to be 8 clock hours. As we can see, many clock hours involving and plus disease, zone 2 and stage 3. So an easy way to remember is 1 and 2 is 3 and 3 plus 5 is equal to 8. So 1 and 2 is zone 1 and 2. If they have stage 3 with the plus, it should be contiguous 5 and non-contiguous 8. So 1 and 2 is 3. 3 + 5 = 8. That is how we can remember a threshold ROP. So pre-threshold may not be required, because once you know this, anything other than this is a pre-threshold. So there can be vitreous haze, which can be graded as grade 0, no, none, which is visible. Mild, where a minimal amount of disc or a macula can be seen. And moderate, where it is significantly obscure. Again, very important terminology, something which is called as a type 1 ROP. This was defined by the ET ROP, or early treatment protocol of ROP, where they identified that if the zone 1 is having any plus of any stage, then it is treatable. And if it is stage 3 in zone 1 without a plus also, it needs to be treated. So if it is zone 1, A plus, that is any stage plus, yes, it is type 1. Or if it is 3 minus, that is if it has gone into a new vascularization stage and still the plus is not there but is in zone 1, we need to treat. In zone 2, if it is only in stage 2 or 3, but yes, we need to remember it has to be plus. So in zone 2, 2 or 3 plus. If it is plus, then only we need to treat. So something which is called as an APROP, very important right now, because more younger children or very low birth weight children are surviving. So very early on, you may see this kind of APROP in them, because the earliest sign, if we miss, we may lose the eye or lose the vision for that child because of APROP. It is uncommon, rapidly progressive, and a severe form of ROP, something which is called as a rush disease also previously. It occurs in smaller children and more immature infants. And if it is untreated, it progresses to stage 5 very fast or rapidly. Posterior location, prominence of plus, it is very ill-defined and mild appearing and easily overlooked. Retinopathy at the junction of the vascular and avascular retina. So this is an image of an APROP. Yes, there is no staging in this. As we can see, there is just a vascular retina and a vascular retina, and we are somewhere in zone 1. As you can see, probably this may be the fovea or this may be the fovea right now. It's not yet developed. But yes, it's a posterior location, ill-defined. It's zone 1 and zone 2, mild appearing. As you can see, it's really mild at this point. But yes, the plus is there. As you can see, the tortuosity is there, dilatation is there, some kind of new blood vessels which are seen over here. Easily overlooked if we are in a hurry to just finish the ROP screening, yes, we may easily overlook. No classical stage, no staging is what we can see. Whom to screen? Please remember 2, 3, 4. Right now, these are the guidelines in India which we are following. 2 is less than 2000 grams of if the baby is there, and of any child who's less than 34 weeks. Any child who's more than 34 weeks, if he's having any high risk factors like some heart problems or prolonged oxygen therapy, RDS, or blood transfusion, sepsis, or intraventricular hemorrhage, apnea, or poor weight gain. And if the pediatrician feels that the child is really at high risk, then probably yes. But important is 2, 3, 4, that is 2000 grams and less than 34 weeks, which has been proposed in this project of operational guidelines of ROP. When it has to be screened? So when the answer is less than 30 days or before the child is discharged from an NICU, at least first eye checkup should be done. So the previous all 3 weeks, 4 weeks, 28 weeks, you need to screen less than that. All those things, leave it, because right now the operational guidelines have clearly told that it has to be less than 30 weeks. So if you mention 3 or 4 weeks, that should be good enough. Yes, you can mention one more line if the child is sick with comorbid conditions. 2 or 3 weekly examination would be better, because the child may have something which is called as an APROP. So what is the natural history of ROP? Something which we need to know, what is called as post-menstrual age. I would come to the details for that. So usually ROP evolves from 34 to 44 weeks, and beyond that, it usually subsides. So we need to usually keep checking the child by around 45, or right now there are indications still 50 weeks also. So this is something which is called as a corrected gestational age or a post-menstrual age. So post-menstrual age is the age which we add the chronological age if the child is born at 28 weeks and it is 2 weeks that is chronological. So the post-menstrual age would be around 30 weeks, or a corrected gestational age would be around 30 weeks. Okay. So the child is born at 28, and if you see the child at 2 weeks, it's 30 weeks. Okay. So the natural history of ROP. the ROP outcome is typically poor if it is unscreened. If unscreened, we may probably lose the eye for having any potential of better vision, because the child may have something which is called as retinal fold or retinal detachment or stage 5, which it may land up. So this is an ROP sequelae. As we can see, the peripheral detachment is still there, but the posterior pole is still attached. When to review, as we were discussing, the earliest or the first examination has to be less than 30 days. And beyond that, if we see the ROP is there, then depending at what stage, if it is in zone 1 or 2, a frequent follow-up, that is 1 or 2 weekly follow-up. And if we see any plus, then yes, less than that, probably around 3 days or 4 days follow-up may also be required. And if it is in zone 3 or probably just immature, probably 2 or 3 weeks a review can be done. So this is much more detailed that if no ROP is there or if ROP is there, these are all available online. So, but it all depends on whether the ROP is there. If the ROP is there, then we treat. If it is treated, then we follow up at 1 week and then 2 weeks and 3 weeks later. So when do we discontinue ROP screening? So the most important, when do we discontinue that? Yes, the child is completely fit, that the development of ROP, the risk is very low. 50 weeks or 45 weeks, we can extend till 50 weeks is what right now the discussions are of post-menstrual age. If the vascularization has reached the zone 3, and if whatever the ROP was there has regressed and the vascularization has reached in zone 3, we can discontinue ROP screening in those cases. So what all we need to have at the time of ROP check, or when you go for an ROP screening? Indirect ophthalmoscope, spare bulb, if you have a 20D lens or a 30D lens, a pediatric speculum, a pediatric depressor, wire vectors, dilating drops, sterile cotton. If you have ROP documents, like as in this case, this is a diary which is being maintained by an NICU over there, that we would come, we would have a coordinator, our name, who would be screening, and the children who needs to be screened or whom to be screened, as we had discussed, less than 34 and 2000 grams. They would have an appointment, as we had discussed, that the days have to be fixed, that if you're visiting one day in a week, it has to be frequent on that days itself rather than changing days. Numbers are written and so that they can be followed up. And then when we are asking them to follow up, would again give them an appointment. This is how we maintain our records, that at what level the pupil is dilated, what stage, if it is zone 3 vascularization, then when it has to be reviewed, we give them a date so that when they need to come. This is an ROP card which mentions the all the details for the child and the next follow-up. So there are discussions of various lenses which need to be utilized for ROP. The ideal would be a 28 diopter lens, where it has a wider field of view, a lesser magnification, and the working distance. As we can see, the working distance is much less because you may not have that kind of a working distance for a small unit. The other possibility of lens is 2.2, which has a similar magnification and field of view and a working distance a little better. 28 diopter, if you do not have an option of 28 or a 2.2, yes, it can be done. So what all drops can be used for ROP? So as we were discussing, it needs to be a diluted drop, and most of the drops are 1:1 dilution. As you can see, a combination of filariferin and tropicamide is the most commonest used drops. A plain tropicacil drops are also there. Cyclopentolate or plain filariferin drops are also there. So drops have to be put 3 times in a 10 minutes interval. And after that, if an additional procedure has to be performed, some kind of a laser or a screening protocol, then probably cyclopentolate can be added to increase the dilation cycle. There are side effects of using these drops. As we can see in the child here, we can see the more icteric area, because this is the area where the drops have been put and those have not been wiped. And the dropper bottle is not used. Probably they use the syringes. So that's why the dropper drop is wider. So such children may have systemic side effects like increased hypertension or probably tachycardia. And certain children are also known to go into brady or apneic spells. So swaddling is an important procedure when we perform an ROP screening, where we make the child comfortable in a wrap around, where the child is comfortably lying down on a flat surface. We can use a pidget which is dipped in 50% dextrose or probably expressed breast milk to decrease the discomfort at the time of screening, what we do. So as in this case, what we are using Alfonso speculum, as we were discussing, so the when it closes completely one over each so that we can put it over the eyelid easily. So these are the different areas or quadrants which we are examining. Right now, this is an inferior nasal quadrant. Avoid overlapping of the hands. So that's why switching the hands or using both your hands for indentation and visualization is better. As in this case, we can see for visualizing different areas, we need to switch the instruments in our hand, inferior temporal, as you could see. Again, timing of treatment, when it would be. Type 1, if it is, as we were discussing, any plus in zone 1 needs to be treated. If it is stage 3, yes, if there is no plus, still it needs to be treated. And if it is zone 2 and stage 2 or 3, it has to be plus, then only it would be counting in type 1 for a treatment. What all options do we have for the treatment? Cryotherapy, which right now is not as commonly practiced, laser treatment, anti-VEGF, which is usually used either before laser or either before surgery, and surgery. So cryo. So as you can see, the cryo treatment over here had higher complication rates. So that's why right now most of the treatment has been switched to the laser. Cryo applications have to be contiguous and only in the vascular area and avoiding the ridge, as you can see over here. And these would be the cryo scars, which are much denser scars, which would follow later on, which have more complications like eyelid edema, lacerations of the conjunctiva, pre-retinal or the vitreous hemorrhage, or systemic complications, because it is a very painful procedure to undergo cryo. Probably an anesthesia would be required. So bradycardia, oculocardic reflex, cyanosis, or respiratory depression. As we were discussing, this is the first and the pioneering study for ROP, something which is called as a cryo ROP, where the cryo was used for the treatment. So some details about it, that it was the largest investigation for a pediatric ophthalmic disease. More than 20 years of data was collected from 23 centers in the United States in 1980. The primary goal of ROP, cryo ROP study, was to resolve uncertainty about the value of peripheral ablation treatment, whether the treatment is actually required, because at that point of time, there was no protocol whom to treat, when to treat. The secondary goal was to determine whether the long-term outcome of the treatment for severe ROP, whether it was better with the treatment or without treatment. So these were the results. As you can see, around 256 infants were included. As you can see, only 49% had unfavorable outcome. So, but still, as we are discussing, 50% eyes are still lost out of it. And at 10 years, it's near to again 50% where it was having unfavorable, less than 20 by 200 vision. So whether this study gave us something positive, yes. That most importantly, we need to look for something which is called as a pre-threshold, not the threshold as we were discussing earlier, where it has to be in stage 3 in zone 1 or 2 with plus at least 5 or 8 contiguous clock hours, 5 contiguous, 8 non-contiguous clock hours. So whether if we need to wait till that point, whether it develops to a threshold or we can treat earlier. So it gave us an answer that yes, we can treat earlier also. And that's why this study was taken up, which is called as ETROP study, which is an early treatment where they identified a high-risk population in a pre-threshold ROP, as we are discussing. So 1 and 2, as we had discussed, that in zone 1 and 2, anything which is having stage 3 with plus in 5 contiguous or 8 non-contiguous, anything less than that, also whether it would help if we treat. Yes, they found out in this study was that yes, an early treatment would be better with laser, obviously. And yes, type 1, as we were discussing, that in zone 1, if we have any plus or if we have stage 3 without plus also, it needs to be treated. And in type 2, which is called as wait and watch, where anything less than type 1 can be wait and watch, so that may resolve by itself or it may require a laser later on. So the laser therapy is the standard treatment of ROP presently. It's less invasive and less traumatic to the eye. less discomfort to the child because the pain is much less. We can use either an NDR double frequency laser that is green or a red diode laser with an indirect ophthalmoscope. The laser has to be done in the anterior avascular retina, anterior to the edge, excluding the ridge. Usually it can be performed just under a topical anesthesia. So yes, red or green, always the discussion is there whether the red is better than green. The studies are done, but the sample size is not adequate to give us an exact answer which is better. Yes, but we have an advantages of red and advantages of green. The red is advantageous because it has a larger spot size and it is an invisible range. So the other person who are assisting you may not use a safety gear like a protective glasses. And it can be done in cases of hazy media and vitreous hemorrhage. Green laser, yes, the advantage is the spot size titration is better and is less painful and causes less inflammation. But the red, because it causes a lot of inflammation because it gets absorbed in a choroid. The most important problem is the titration of the burn in red because we don't know what is adequate. As you can see, this is the laser which we are performing. So most importantly, when we are performing a laser, dilatation has to be done. The child has to be comfortable, wrapped. As we are seeing, it has to be started with the as minimal power as possible, probably at 175. And then if we are not seeing the power is coming up, gradually increasing. The duration, we can keep it from 100 to 200 and go till 300. Most importantly, in between, we need to keep seeing the monitor also. Sometimes we may have apneic spells or probably bradycardia, as we can see in some children. At that point of time, we need to wait, remove the speculum, and then stimulate the child. In certain rare cases, the child may need resuscitation to come out of the apneic spells. Laser technique, as we are discussing, this is a case where we have already done a laser. How the laser is done is from anterior to posterior, you keep marking the area till where you want to do the laser. The posterior most edge marking is very important because it has to be in a circular fashion, as you can see. It should not be wavy as much as possible. And then once this area is covered, then you do rasterly in between and then cover those areas. As most of the textbooks describe, it is confluent laser, not like a PRP. Ideally, overlapping burn should be avoided because of complications like retinal breaks or hemorrhages or tears within the laser burns. So half disc burn difference if we keep, because in this children, as we can see, the burn expands. So as you can see, here certain areas are still viable retina is there, but that's okay, nothing to worry about. Complications of laser, as we can see over here, that when we are doing laser, if the laser hits the area of a ridge or where, if there is a new blood vessel over there, it may cause a little area of vitreous hemorrhage. Yes, other complications like iris burns or corneal burns, cataract, retinal or vitreous hemorrhage can be there. Ocular ischemic syndrome, yes, very rare. Anterior ischemic syndrome can also occur. Angle closure glaucomas, inadvertent damage to the vascularized retina or probably breaks also may occur. As we were discussing, apneic spells may occur. Late complications like peripheral vision loss for the child, myopia, astigmatism, squint or amblyopia is common. Once we do a laser, the first follow-up is 7 days later. And the child in which if we require more number of burns, it is better to add some kind of mediatrics also. Otherwise, just mild dose steroids for 7 days would be better. After the examination, we need to evaluate every 1 week to see whether the regression is occurring and if there is any add-on treatment which is required. And yes, as we are discussing, long-term follow-up has to be stressed to the parents because the complications, late complications associated with it, like myopia, squint, or amblyopia. As we can see in this case, we have done a laser where it has already scarred, but there are certain areas which are still left. So this is much posterior. As you can see, somewhere the macula may be here. So that's why as and as we see that the proliferation of this hemorrhages are decreasing, and if the blood vessels are entering into the lasered area, we can still wait and add laser may be done in a delayed fashion. So yes, whether there are other studies which help to decrease the ROP, a stop study where they utilized supplement therapeutic oxygen. In this case, a conventional 89% to 94% of oxygen versus a supplemental 96% to 99%. Whether a supplemental oxygen is beneficial, whether we need to give more oxygen to avoid development of ROP, as this study has mentioned, yes, the pre-threshold is affected minimally, but otherwise the threshold ROP has no effect at all. yes, giving extra oxygen has more complications like pneumonia or retained hospitalization because of more oxygen requirement or diuretics. So these are other studies like the Boost 1 support or Boost 2 studies. The initial studies, they probably have seen on the upper limit to whether we can give more oxygen. And the later studies like support or Boost 2 or COT have given an answer whether whether we need to give a little lower SpO2. So this is a meta-analysis, again, an important study in NEPROM, where a neonatal oxygen prospective meta-analysis was done for all the studies where, as we can see, favor of higher SpO2 is better as compared to the favoring on a lower SpO2. Higher means not to 100%, but yes, somewhere around 94 to 95% is what we are looking at. So what is the discussion or final outcome of this study? Yes, if we give less oxygen, there is increased mortality. So because of necrotizing enterocolitis, intravitreal hemorrhages, hypoxia, encephalitis, and other things. As you can see, there is still decreased risk of ROP, but if the child doesn't survive, what is the point? So yes, this is a trade-off that yes, we may give a little higher, as you're discussing, not 100%, somewhere around 40, 95 to 94%, where it increased survival without morbidity, as we can see, without morbidity. But yes, minimal ROP, whichever develops, would be better taken care of by the newer advances like laser or anti-VEGF. Other studies like Elgin, which identifies that the children who have high PCO2 or a high pH would have a severe form of an ROP. So this studies are something which is called the telemedicine studies for ROP. If we have an option for telemedicine like a red cam or a neo red cam, then all the studies have shown that yes, telemedicine works as good. There are Indian studies also, but Dr. Anand sir, this is again a very important study, a bevacizumab, which eliminates the anti-VEGF threat to ROP, a BEAT study. So yes, this gives us an answer whether the anti-VEGF helps us treating ROP. In this case, it was evaluated for zone 1 and zone 2, posterior stage 3 and plus. As you can see, it is just a half dose, 0.025. It identified that yes, in zone 1, it had a better outcome. But otherwise, in zone 2, it didn't have as better outcome as in compared to zone 1. So yes, in zone 1 and stage 3 plus, we can still consider this. This is the most important statement in this. The development of peripheral retinal vascularization continued even after the treatment with anti-VEGF. What does that mean? See this image. So what we are seeing over here is, this is a conventional patient which is treated by laser. As you can see, the blood vessels are stopping short where the laser has been done, and beyond that doesn't go. But this is after anti-VEGF. As you can see, this is after bevacizumab or treatment with anti-VEGF, where the blood vessels still grow further, but there is still an area of a vascularization or non-vascularized area still at 13 months. That is at 1 year also. So yes, the question arises whether the anti-VEGF is safe. That kind of answer is still not there. Whether any other anti-VEGF can also be used, yes, ranibizumab, they have studied with a lesser concentration, 0.2 or 0.1. The study has stated that 0.2 might be superior, as we have again discussed, only till around 24 weeks of safety profile, because the safety profile of this anti-VEGF is still not known. So the advantage is monotherapy, only anti-VEGF. Yes, the ease of administration at 1.5 mm, you just give the injection and then the ROP regresses. And more rapid response, you would see the ROP regressing faster, as we could see in the previous image. Disadvantages, long-term systemic effects are still not studied or known, like brain, liver, heart, or kidney. Yes, if we give it too early, the normal vascularization is also affected. If we give it too late, then it causes retinal detachment because the fibrous component also takes over. Yes, the important, as you were discussing, even at 1 year also, the complete vascularization has not occurred. The recurrences are very important. And as you can see in certain studies, 1/4, that is 25% of patients had recurrence. And these are variable results because the number is not adequate. So it's very difficult to say just anti-VEGF alone would be helpful. Ideally, anti-VEGF in monotherapy has to be avoided. It is better that we give it in an anti-adjuvant so that to avoid vascularization, go beyond zone 1 so that we are avoiding macula. and laser for recurrent ROPs, if we have to do a bridging laser or additional laser treatment in cases of failure of laser or ROP, or preoperative therapy, as we know that if there is a bleeding or an extreme vascular disease where we need to give anti-VEGF and then probably do a vitrectomy or a scleral puncture. Surgical options in ROP, yes, if we have stage 4 and there is no focal detachment, only a traction, it can still be followed up. But if there is a generalized traction, probably a 360 degree buckling has to be done. If there is a localized traction, then probably a vitrectomy, buckle, or a localized buckle, or something which is called as a MIROPS, which our mentor Dr. Mahesh is doing, I would discuss it over here. And if it is stage 4B where the macula is off, LSV or a lens-sparing vitrectomy can help. So this was a child which had an AP-ROP, an aggressive posterior ROP. As you can see, the blood vessels are still not gone beyond zone 1, and vitreous hemorrhage and severe plus, as we can see, where we gave anti-VEGF and then did laser. As you can see, the laser has taken up very well. ROP has near completely resolved. As you can see, this is only a focal traction, but there is no detachment as such in this case. So if this is this cases can be still observed frequently. If there is a generalized traction, so this is by our mentor, Dr. Mahesh, as we can see that 360 degree buckling procedure, which we are performing in this child, a 360 degree congenital peritomy has to be done, a usual procedure what we follow. Tenon's dissection is very important considering a neonate. I'm sorry for this. Blunt tenons dissection adequately, and it has to be done well so that the tagging of the muscles have to be done or it helps us better tagging of the muscles. And then making grooves, what we do over here at in Sankara Hospital, Bangalore, is to make grooves or a sutureless buckle and pass the band. And 360 degree, once you have passed the band, then we use a sleeve and then tighten the buckle. So to see the adequacy or tightening of the buckle, we can either do a paracentesis if the pressure, I mean, if the indent has to be found out adequately. SRF drainage in such cases are usually not indicated. Outcome of ROP scleral buckling, as we are seeing, the redetachment rates range between 46 to 70%. Yes, the vitrectomy is taking over, which is around 72% right now. Some cons associated with scleral buckling, advantages are formation of cataract is not there. But disadvantage is that we need to remove the buckle by around 6 or 9 months because it hampers the growth of the eye and also erode the developing eye. So this is one of the case where, as we can see, the retina has a tractional detachment which is only involving in the peripheral part, where after buckle, as you can see, the peripheral traction has been relieved. Posterior folds have also settled well. I'm sorry. So vitrectomy, if you are planning for a LSV, that's a lens-sparing vitrectomy, there are certain issues in infants that the lens is a little large or bulkier. Entry site is usually from the pars plicata. As you can see, the entry is not from the pars plana as in adults. It is usually from the pars plicata. And lens is larger, as we are seeing. So if we cannot move the instrument much beyond the posterior pole, as we can see over here. And detachment of the posterior vitreous is not as easy or very difficult in cases of ROP. In certain cases, we can only do in certain areas and we need to leave beyond that. If any break occurs, the eye is lost. So most importantly, avoid having any breaks if possible. Cycloidic and pupillary membrane development later on as anterohyaloid proliferations and functional development may take years. So where do you take a sclerotomy? So this is a most important table to identify that if the child is less than 6 months, we need to enter somewhere around 1.5. And if it is 6 to 12 months, we can enter at around 1.5 to 2 mm. What all forces act in cases of ROP at the ridge? So this is one, ridge to anterior hyoid. Second, ridge to ridge, ridge to optic nerve. And then yes, the ridge to anterior vitreous base. So there are four different traction forces which can act. In this case, as we can see, we are doing a vitrectomy for a tractional detachment, which is involving the fovea. As you can see over here, we have induced, we are trying to induce a posterior hyoid detachment within triamcinolone assistance, but as you can see, it's so tightly adherent that it doesn't come off as easily as in cases of adults. And in certain times, we would not be able to induce beyond the posterior pole itself. So we are just removing that membrane or attraction over the fovea or the macula, and then we are leaving it and we're not continuing with the vitrectomy like we do in cases of adult vitrectomies where we continue the detachment, posterior vitreous detachment further. So this was, as we were discussing, this is something which is called as MIROPS, or a minimal invasive ROP surgery, where we are, as you can see, the traction is only involving the temporal most part of it. So not using a three-port approach, but only a two-port approach, or sometime a single-port approach. In this case, we are just identifying where we need to enter. So this is the point we have identified where we are entering, and this is the area where we can see the traction or the pull is there. Here is the fold, and the posterior pole is attached. As we can see, the macula is on. So using just a scissors, no infusion, and this is a formed vitreous, so the eye doesn't collapse. But yes, if we keep doing it for a longer time, the vitreous may prolapse through the ports and the eye may become soft. So that has to be avoided. So this is, we are removing the anterior posterior traction so that it goes and settles back. So as you can see, at the end of the surgery, the traction which was there over here has gone behind. So this is how a localized traction can be managed. If it's a stage 5, yes, an open sky approach, which is usually not followed right now, all are closed globe procedures. So as you can see, this is a case where we have done a lensectomy, and we have done a pupil, all iris also has been eaten up by the cutter. And then we are dissecting the membrane. As we were discussing, there are 5 different forces which are acting: ridge from the ridge, ridge to anterior vitreous, ridge to disc, and ridge to anterior hyoid. So all those attachments need to be dissected. So there are different techniques, inside out and outside in. There is a combination of both. In this case, so we were able to manage by just outside in, or coming from outside in. This is our mentor, Dr. Mahesh, who's operating. And then the remaining part of the fibrous tissue can be eaten up with the cutter. ROP or a stage 5 is not like an RRD or a rheumatogenous retinal detachment where a break is there. It's like a lycra material where everything is pulled together. So once the traction is relieved, we hope that it goes back by itself and then attaches. Yes, unfortunately, if we have any break intraop, then yes, we may lose the eye. So this is another case. In this case, we were fortunate enough that there was some kind of a membrane which was bridging in the anterior part, and the posteriorly the funnel was actually open. So once we had dissected the anterior proliferative membrane, then we can see the posteriorly the retina is attached, and this is some kind of a fold which is still remaining. So as we can see, we have done an air fluid exchange, and we can see that the retina is on the back part of the eye is still attached posteriorly. So outcome of the stage 5, yes, the outcome ranges from 14% to 90% depending when we are intervening. Multiple approaches, that yes, the resurgeries may be required in certain cases, lensectomy, complications of amblyopia, vision rehabilitation. Very difficult, yes, the reattachment rates are very high. It ranges from around 50% to 74%. ROP eyes are very difficult to operate, as we know. Yes, the vitrectomy eyes better to operate rather than to leave, because if we are able to salvage at least around 5 to 10% of the eyes also, some children can still see. As we can see, this child is having a detachment, but still the child is able to move around with having some mobile vision, not a very good vision for reading, but some mobile vision. There are certain not ROP cases which you may see when you're doing an ROP screening. Like in this case, this child was having was of 36 weeks. This is the corrected gestational age with 1.8 kilogram weight. And then when we were seeing the child, we could see that multiple hemorrhages, but there is no plus. As you can see, there is no plus, no tortuosity. And the hemorrhages are bilateral, both eyes, and involving posterior pole, periphery, and multiple areas. When we found out, when we went through the file, then we found out that the child was having anemia and thrombocytopenia also. So yes, sometimes anemia and thrombocytopenia can also have associated hemorrhages like this, which is not ROP. We need to keep following it up closely 2 or 3 weekly, and then see whether the temporal periphery is vascularized. If it's vascularized, these hemorrhages go away by itself. As you can see, it gets resolved over a period of time. Something which is called a systemic plus. So this child also is around 40 weeks, but is severely IUGR, as we know, is 1.8 only, and also was having severe thrombocytopenia. As you can see, subconjunctival hemorrhages, it was not because we were examining, but it was before itself. As you can see, the venules are really dilated, which at this age is not expected. So children who are having intrauterine growth retardation of a very severe extent, we can see this kind of plus disease where we would not see an ROP. Again, routine follow-up and see for any systemic association should be done. Yes, most importantly, we may see some kind of an ROP, kind of a sequelae, like a band kind of a thing. But yes, something else other than ROP, which is called as a PHPV or a persistent fetal vasculature, which can be there, where we can see that there can be a cataract and a persistent band, and usually in the inferonasal quadrant, which may extend to the disc and usually temporally or nasally also. We may have certain times visibility issues, like we may see a little hazy. That can be because of corneal haze, which can be present in a very early or a very, very low birth weight children or very early child, which we examine probably 26 or 28 weeks. And there may be again haze because of cataract also. So we need to do some kind of a retro reflex with your indirect, and you would be able to see this. Yes, we have also seen something which is called as a Batter baby syndrome at a very early age, where a fully normal child was brought to us probably around 2 months later for evaluation. As we can see, the child had a history of fall, not sure what the reason was behind that. And then, as you can see, these are self-limiting. If the hemorrhages are involving the macula and non-resolving, these may require surgery also. This was one of the rare cases where a term child with a full term delivery, as you can see, the forceps delivery or probably an intraventricular hemorrhage has caused a vitreous hemorrhage, which worsened over a week, and then we needed a surgery for this to remove it. And there was actually a subretinal hemorrhage also in this case. So that is also known, something which is called a Tursen syndrome. Yes, this is my last slide. So take home message is, one, ROP has zones 1, 2, and 3. It has stages, as we had discussed. One, where a demarcation line would be there between vascular and avascular retina. Two, something which is called as ridge, where we can see the breadth may also be there with the demarcation line, or thickness may come up. Three, where the neovascularization comes up into the vitreous cavity. Four, a detachment. 4A, where the detachment is not involving fovea. 4B, where it is involving fovea. 5, as we were discussing, a total retinal detachment, which has different presentations like anterior open, posterior closed, open, or open closed, or open closed, or closed open type. Yes, plus and pre-plus is very important, as we were discussing. Plus, we need to remember that ideal image with which we were showing, that the arteriolar tortuosity has to be there, venular dilatation and tortuosity has to be there. Anything less than that, then at least 2 quadrants should be involved. And then if it is anything less than that, pre-plus, AP-ROP, as you were discussing, we can miss it very easily. Careful examination, it would be presenting in zone 1 and 2 with no classical type of stages. But yes, proliferation, severe plus can be seen very premature, very early. ET-ROP told us that something which is called as type 1, which has to be treated. Type 1 is zone 1 plus any plus of disease, as you were discussing, and if it is stage 3 and with no plus, even we need to treat if it is in zone 1. If it is in zone 2, stage 2 and 3, but yes, it has to have a plus with it. When to screen, as we had discussed, 2, 3, 4, this is what we are following in India right now, less than 2000 grams and less than 34 weeks. Has to be screened. Anyone who's more than 34 weeks should have any high risk factors, or if the pediatrician thinks that it has to be screened. Treatment options, as we had discussed, that yes, after evaluation, after using the ROP drops, as we had discussed, 1:1 dilution drops, we can evaluate the child after saddling, as we were discussing. If the child requires treatment, yes, we have options of red and green, as we had discussed, the green, because the titration of the spot is better. Red, if the protective equipments are not there for other persons, because it's an infrared. Yes, the difficult point is that the titration of the spot is difficult, but the advantage is that the larger spot size, and yes, lesser number of bones. But yes, it is a little painful for the child. Anti-VEGF, as we had discussed, ideally at this scenario in India, considering only monotherapy for an anti-VEGF would not be applicable. Add-on or an adjuvant therapy, anti-VEGF before treatment of your laser, decreasing vascularity for your surgery would be better. surgical options, as you were discussing, a sterile buckle, where it can be a 360 degree buckle, or it can be a localized buckle or a radial buckle. Yes, other options we have is LSV or a lens sparing vitrectomy, as we were discussing. We need to go from, if the child is 0 to 6 months, 1.5 millimeter from the limbus, from the pars plicata, which we need to go. Yes, we cannot do a complete vitrectomy. Inducing the PVD would be very difficult in such children. Only removing the traction would be better. But yes, if the child lands up into something which is called a stage 5, lensectomy, vitrectomy would be required, where the all pupil, the iris may also need to be abscised. Tamponade at this point, if somebody asks, yes, if there is no break, tamponade may not be required. As you were discussing, this is more traction associated retinal detachment rather than an RRD. Yes, there can be very rare situations where the RRD is there. In those cases, a tamponade may be required, an oil, very rarely a gas. Visual rehabilitation, yes, this is a step one. If we are doing anything, re-evaluating again, probably till 5 years is very important, because formation of myopia, amblyopia, squint is associated with ROP. Something which is not ROP has also to be careful about, like thrombocytopenia, anemia, retinopathy can be there, or systemic plus, where the venule dilatation may be there without ROP. Battered baby syndrome, you can see hemorrhages at various levels. PHPV can also be one of the presentations, cataract, and very rarely tarsal syndrome. So thank you. Yes, the ROP children can do see. So we are open for question and answers.
I'm Dr. Saptagirish here. Thank you, Dr. Divyansh. It's been a wonderful, wonderful talk. I really enjoyed it myself. And I'm sure all that will be listening have really enjoyed the talk. Very comprehensive and very nice. I just take some questions. There are some questions. I just read them out. Dr. Anupama has written that I instill dilatation drops 1:1, tropicacil plus only once. Pupil dilates well. That's a comment that the doctor is making.
Just a minute, yeah. So yes, we can instill drops just once, and dilatation may occur. The problem with this kind of dilatation is that the constriction also is faster. So yes, a single drop does work in most of the cases, but if you see the pupil would start constricting less than half an hour. So if you are able to see the child, and if you do not have many children lined up in an ROP clinic, yes, you can.
Dr. Keshav is asking, does ROP like retinopathy in full-term infants behave differently? And is it more aggressive or needs more frequent follow-ups?
So this is a rare scenario where, whether we call it as ROP like retinopathy or because it's associated with prematurity itself. So yes, the case reports are there where the full-term infants are also having something which is called a stage 5 total detachment or a proliferation which occurs. But it's very difficult to screen everyone, because right now they are trying to get screening for everyone protocol by Dr. Subhadra Jalali madam and by Dr. Anand Vinaykar sir, that all children need to be screened in less than 30 days is what they are proposing. So this kind of problem can be tackled then, but right now I'm not sure whether we have such kind of a manpower to screen even normal children. So whether it behaves differently, very rarely, as I showed you one image where the child was complete term, but still there was some kind of a plus disease. And I'm still following it up closely, because such children where they are term and they're having some kind of intrauterine, probably growth retardation, which causes intrauterine ischemia, which causes kind of a proliferation which occurs later on after term pregnancy, is what we are looking at. But there are very limited data available that whether it would be more aggressive. Difficult to answer this question, whether it would be more aggressive.
Right. Dr. Devashish is asking, in which situations would we give an anti-VEGF prior to surgery, and the indications for putting a BB in ROP?
So indications for putting a BB in ROP, as we were discussing, BB means a belt buckle. So belt buckle would be better in cases where we have a circumferential peripheral traction causing four A kind of a disease where peripheral traction is there to, so that we relieve the circumferential traction. And then as we were discussing that it has to be removed at 6 or 9 months to avoid the eye growth. Anti-VEGF prior to the surgery, as we were discussing, yes, those are adjuvants. If we see that the proliferation is vascular, is really vascular, as in this case, we can see this is the case which we had given an anti-VEGF and then we had done laser because it was too premature a child. And then we had to manage some time, probably around 2 or 3 weeks till the time child was mature enough for a anesthesia. So as you can see, if there is severe vascularity, we would not be able to do a proper surgery. So important is when to inject and when to operate. So as we were discussing in this case, as we are seeing that this is having, this is how it started at presentation. As we can see, this is an AP-ROP where severe proliferation, we are not seeing just vitreous hemorrhage. There is no proliferation grossly, which is seen. So in such cases, giving an anti-VEGF, then doing laser, decreasing the vascularity, and then operating would be better. So it's the vascularity which we are decreasing so that you are operating on more fibrous component rather than a vascular component, because it's not like diabetes where you would be able to dissect and delaminate proliferation from the retina. It's not that easy.
Right. Dr. Rohit is asking, till what time should we follow up regressed ROP babies who are showing a small temporal avascular area in every follow-up?
So as we are discussing that when to stop ROP or when to when not to follow is still 50 weeks is what we need to see. If you see that only a temporal area is avascular and it's in zone 3 and there is no ROP and it's 50 weeks, we can leave it. The next checkup should be around 6 months later. Because if there is any ROP and you are not able to see properly, and if you have a doubt, better is to do an examination under anesthesia and thoroughly evaluate the periphery. And if you see it's just avascular, we can still observe. But if you see that there is any residual ROP or something which is called as a lingering ROP, in those cases, we can do a laser in just that area. But as you have mentioned, it's just a temporal avascular. So the answer is probably keep following it till 50 weeks. And if there is no ROP, then we can discharge in from ROP follow.
Dr. Ravi Shankar is asking whether the ROP can be asymmetric.
Yes, the ROP asymmetry is there, but very rare cases where only one eye has developed like stage 5 and the other eye does not show any. We also have only one case. I'm not sure for any specific reason for it. Whether the child is having any heart problem where there is a right shunt where only the right eye is having more blood supply and the left eye doesn't have. So whether that may be one of the reasons is, I'm not sure. Yes, we have seen asymmetric rare presentations. Yes. Usually those are mild asymmetries what we can see. As we can see, this is one eye and the other eye, the image which I showed where it was having an AP-ROP where it was, you can see the blood vessels and the hemorrhage was not as this worse. So it's usually a little asymmetrical, but yes, we have seen a gross asymmetry where the other eye is having near complete and the other eye, one eye may have stage 5 or stage 4 ROP.
Right. Dr. Amir has a question. He wants to know, in regard to intravitreal injections for ROP, how many millimeters from the limbus and what is the dosage?
As we are discussing right now, the intravitreal injection, the biggest question which arises is there are multiple anti-VEGFs which are available, bevacizumab, ranibizumab, and even aflibercept, which people are starting to inject. Better is to avoid aflibercept still. Ranibizumab, the only advantage is safety because it's a single vial which you get. But ideal would be bevacizumab because considering the systemic absorption is much less because it's a larger molecule. But as I showed you that the Rainbow study has shown that even one third the dose, not even half, one third, the dose is also effective. And at what distance, as I discussed in my slides, that till 6 months, 0 to 6 months, 1.5, that is you are going through a fast plicator. and directing the needle towards the center of the vitreous cavity and not trying to look that whether you are actually seeing the needle, because the tip of the needle, because then you would injure the lens in between.
And Dr. Maithili Mishra would want to know, when do you consider repeating an anti-VEGF?
So when do we repeat? Because most of the papers do not talk about when do we repeat, because then the whole point of monotherapy is gone. So even in Rainbow study and Beat study, there were at least around 1 or 2% of cases which required repeat anti-VEGF. This is only monotherapy as we are discussing. So repeat anti-VEGF in a monotherapy, yes, that may be an indication. Otherwise, one of the children which we had managed, because still when the child was around 36 to 38 weeks, the new vascularization was still very active even after laser. So our case was completely different. I don't know whether you're talking about only monotherapy or a combined treatment. Because in a monotherapy, yes, 2 to 3% of cases require. And if we see that the new vascularization is still persisting, then the treatment or then the anti-VEGF would be required. But in our case, we had done a laser. And in that case, still the new blood vessels were persisting. And in that case, we needed to give a second dose of laser.
Dr. Preeti would want to know, when you're doing a laser for ROP, how do you respect the horizontal meridian to salvage the long ciliary nerves?
So in cases of ROP, usually saving an horizontal meridian or long ciliary nerve is very, very difficult, because yes, the movement. So what you can do it as probably a 3 and 9 o'clock, avoid 1 clock hour. And then probably if you want an additional laser, you can keep it over there as minimal as possible. Out of so many cases which we have seen, probably we have not seen as much, but in a very limited understanding of ROP, what we have, only one case which we had seen which developed anti-segment ischemia, which had corneal haze and then cataract, and then we had to do a cataract surgery for it. The ROP regressed, but in that case, we haven't done so much of laser and we hadn't done laser in horizontal meridian. So in an ROP, it would be a very difficult scenario to respect the horizontal meridian as to salvage. I would say long ciliary nerves are not so much important, but blood vessels, the major long ciliary arteries, would be more important. But difficult.
Dr. Sri Ramcharan has, I think, 2 questions. I just read the first one. He says the zones designed based on chronological development of the vasculature of the retina, like in zone 3, temporal vasculature is last to develop.
So probably is he giving an answer or is he asking questions?
As what we are discussed, yes,
because it's a self-explanatory question. Right.
So and the question yes. 2 is, what is the outcome measure for ongoing treatment in babies with ROP, like pupil reaction or any other clinical measure, as foveal fixation takes almost 3 months.
Ongoing treatment in baby with ROPs, I'm not sure. So what we are doing is, for the visual maturation, we are doing something which is called as vision therapy, where we are exposing the child to different colors of light and different textures, means blinking light, flickering light. So we are doing those kind of treatments so that the visual maturation or integration or the neurodevelopment issues which arise after laser or after ROP should not arise. So we are following up cases till around, like we have cases who are around 5 years also right now of age and 10 years also of age, which sir has been managing before. So most of the cases have 100% vision, yes, but if the fovea is dragged or in structural issues at the fovea because of the laser or dragging of the fovea, in those cases, the vision is less. In cases where the structural or anatomical fovea is normal, but the vision is less, are the cases which has neurodevelopmental delay or associated neuronal abnormality, because as we know, ROP occurs in children who are very premature, and then these children also have multiple associations, systemic associations, neurological associations, and neuro means the connection between an eye and the brain is not as well developed as we are discussing. So stimulations would be the answer, but I'm not sure about the pupillary reaction.
Okay. Dr. Preeti would want to know what you mean by open and closed terminology in RD, in detachment, I guess.
So open or closed means it's the funnel, whether the funnel is open or closed. So as the images we had discussed in that, if the anteriormost area is open, so it's an open funnel. And if the anteriormost area, which is close to the lens, if the area over there is compressed, then it is closed. Means I'm not sure whether I answered that question properly, because it's the funnel which is open or closed.
I think it's quite clear. Dr. Arun is asking, the screening criteria which you mentioned, is it according to which guidelines, and whether it's applicable for the Indian scenario?
As we are discussing, this is what we are following right now. This is something which is called as ROP guidelines, which are given by not NNF or not any of which, because there are a lot of confusions in when to screen, what to screen, and things like that. So the guideline which is provided by the So this is a projection project operational guidelines, which are easily available, which you can see online. And these are given in 2018, which are still followed. And this is for India.
Okay. Dr. Preeti's, Dr. There's another question, like, how do we differentiate from FEVR?
So FEVR usually in such young children would have some kind of an exudation. Yes, there are cases where there is an overlap of FEVR and ROP. But yes, most importantly, familial history would be there in cases of FEVR, and probably prematurity may not be there. It may be a full term. But yes, there are overlaps or case reports of FEVR in premature. So it is probably the exudation is what it may differentiate in a family history. And probably if there is a history of prematurity.
Right. There's a question from Dr. Arpita. She's asking, can you please explain about plasmin-assisted vitrectomy in stage 5 ROP?
So these are adjuvants, I didn't go much in detail because there are many adjuvants other than this also which can be used. So plasmin causes vitreolysis, and that is how, or a posterior vitreous detachment. So that helps in cases of the proliferation or the dense attachment of vitreous which is there onto the retina to lyse it and have a better dissection area, better dissection plane for it. So ideally the plasmins would be used in LSE, that is a lens sparing vitrectomy, where we need to use induce the PVD. Yes, but in stage 5 also it can be used to help dissection, to help a better dissection, because that induces posterior vitreous detachment.
And there's a question by Dr. Srinivas Rao. He's asking, which type of laser is better for treatment?
So as we were discussing, the option for lasers are red and green. My personal choice would be green, because the titration of the burn is very easy. If somebody has used red, then they would understand that titration means what is an exact burn which you would require. It's very difficult to identify, because once you do a laser, the burn takes some time to come up and it keeps growing. And the red laser is a little painful, but the advantage is that the spot size is larger, as we had discussed, yes. And protective equipments, if your persons who are assisting are not there, because it's an infrared laser, it can still be done. So green, but I would prefer still green, considering the titration and the effect of the laser is very easy to titrate.
Right. Dr. Puneet has a question. He's asking that he's seen many arrested or treated ROP grown-up children with high myopia. He would want to know any specific reason for the progressive myopia in such children.
I may not be sure about the specific reason why they develop myopia.
Okay. There's a question by Dr. Anand. He's asking, is there any role of steroids in ROP?
Steroids. I am not sure. I haven't come across. So okay. Probably I would revert back after reviewing the literature.
There are also many other questions from Dr. Preeti and Dr. Maitri. I think they've already asked questions, so we'll not take them. I'm sure that they can reach out to you anytime they have any doubts. Thank you very much, Dr. Divyansh. It's been a wonderful, wonderful talk. The interaction has been wonderful. Thank you very much for the session.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity.
For the tomorrow, we don't have a class. It's a Sunday. Our next class will be on the 13th. The link will be sent and shared with all the in the group as usual. And the time remains the same. It's 12 p.m. to 1 p.m. And the talk is by a glaucoma consultant at Shimoga, Dr. Kamala. We'll be talking on common errors in the diagnosis and management of glaucoma patients. Thank you all. Thank you, Dr. Divyansh, once again.
And thank you, sir.
Have a nice weekend and stay safe. Bye.